We head out west now to rural Oregon, known for its forests and as a place where the timber industry is a major player in the economy. But there's growing concern from some residents about chemical spraying practices. The story comes from our partners at the Center for Investigative Reporting, who produced this story. The correspondent is Ingrid Lobet.
Western Oregon's beautiful forests and fish-filled streams are known as a paradise for nature lovers, but this is also one of the finest timber-growing regions in the world. With 30 million acres of forest land, Oregon's timber industry generates $13 billion in sales each year. But in Triangle Lake, some residents worry that timber industry practices are exposing people to harm.
I want to see one of those again, right here.
Erin King and her family moved here 6 years ago. They bought a one-acre farm, wanting to raise their kids close to the land.
When we found this place and were able to move into this place, we thought we had found it. This is it. This is where we're going to be the rest of our lives.
King knew she was moving into a timber area, but there was something she didn't realize.
I knew that clear-cutting happened, but I did not know that the helicopter spray happened.
This video, shot by King, shows the typical industry practice. After a clear cut, helicopters spray a potent mixture of herbicides to kill everything except fir seedlings. By eliminating plants that compete for sun and water, timber companies can grow the trees faster and harvest more frequently. Residents like King complain they're repeatedly exposed to potentially harmful chemicals through the air and possibly the water.
From up here on top of the ridge, what you can see is the big picture, really. They're spraying with helicopters all these ridge tops, and so everything they're spraying up top eventually gets down to all of these residents.
Concerned, King says she tried to find out exactly what was being sprayed.
They give you a really long laundry list of what they could spray that day, but it doesn't tell you exactly what they're going to spray. And just knowing when they're going to spray would be incredibly helpful. That way I could vacate my land completely, although I don't feel I should have to. But I would love to get my kids out of here.
Instead, Oregon's Department of Forestry sends out notifications like this one, giving a possible 12-month window for spraying and a long list of herbicides that could be used. There are a dozen different herbicides commonly sprayed on forests in Oregon, including possible hormone disruptors like 2,4-D and atrazine. This Oregon Department of Forestry map shows the extent of privately owned timberland where herbicides are routinely sprayed by companies like Weyerhaeuser, Roseburg Resources, and Seneca Jones.
About 7 o'clock, Moses Lake.
Stu Turner is an expert on pesticide accidents. He's told Triangle Lake residents the spraying being done in Oregon is risky.
Now you can see, this is a clear cut right here where you can see the snow. If you look very closely here in the photo, you can actually see a spraying helicopter. You can see one of the two rotors, and you can see the stream of spray that's falling behind the aircraft. You can see the ground is frozen. It's got snow on it. They're putting pesticides on snow. When that snow melts, it's going to go off and run off.
Turner also says that in Oregon's mountainous terrain, helicopters spray herbicides from much higher elevations than in crop agriculture, and that means the chemicals are more likely to drift down to where people live.
They are playing with the most potent of our tools. They're playing with them at the very highest rates allowable for any application, and under worst-case scenario for product leaving the field.
The timber companies declined our repeated invitations for interviews. They referred us instead to a trade group, Oregonians for Food and Shelter, where Terry Witt represented the industry for 25 years.
Forest application of herbicides is done in accordance with the label, in accordance with all state laws. And so we believe that it does not represent an unreasonable harm.
Delivering the herbicides via helicopter, Witt says, is by far the best method.
It's a very economical way to apply a uniform rate of pesticides according to the label. In many cases, the terrain is such that it becomes very impractical to and very dangerous to send people on foot into areas to do spraying.
Witt says he hasn't heard of any cases of wide-scale herbicide contamination from the forest industry. Of course, none of this is an issue on federal land, where nearly all spraying has been banned in Oregon since the 1980s, when residents successfully challenged the use of herbicides, including Agent Orange. Jim Furnish, a former Forest Service deputy chief, says his agency discovered that hand-cutting unwanted brush was just as effective.
Suddenly, then, herbicides no longer were essential or necessary, maybe preferable economically. But you have to bear in mind that this Douglas fir timber is worth a lot of money. So you can afford to do other more costly methods, provided that they're still effective, and turn a handsome profit.
But in Triangle Lake, opposition to the spraying has been growing. Fed up with what they viewed as chemical trespass on their private property, residents banded together, complained to the state, and finally contacted Dr. Dana Barr, a national expert in pesticide exposures at Emory University.
It seemed like a significant enough situation that it should have at least garnered some attention and should have been evaluated.
Barr tested the urine of 41 residents.
I found breakdown products of the herbicides 2,4-D and atrazine in all of the urine samples that we tested.
These herbicides don't stay in the body, so that meant people had been exposed recently.
It was not what I'm used to seeing, that we don't frequently detect these chemicals in urine samples, but it was surprising to find them in all of the samples tested.
When Dr. Barr's sort of results came back, I was stunned. Some of these subjects were children that have just never been exposed. They live in the country, and they live on basically an organic franchise on this little farm. So the only real source has to be the forestry.
Dana Barr's findings also caught the attention of Oregon's health authority. It launched a 2-year study with help from the Centers for Disease Control. The first round of testing also found the herbicide 2,4-D in residents' urine. Herbicides are designed to work on plants, but a growing body of research suggests some may have profound effects on humans. Suzanne Fenton works for the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences.
Herbicides are understudied. There's not a lot of funding for it, but even worse than that is the fact that early life exposures to herbicides are really understudied. We know that many herbicides are endocrine disruptors.
Endocrine disruptors act like hormones, but they relay the wrong signals to and from the brain and reproductive system. Fenton has found that mice whose mothers were exposed to atrazine for just 3 days while pregnant experienced changes that lasted throughout their lives. Atrazine is heavily used in Oregon forestry.
It can affect pubertal timing. So it can affect breast development during the period of puberty. It can then also, if it persists, if the effect persists, it can affect lactation. So it can affect the ability of the mom to provide nutrients to her offspring.
Syngenta, the company that manufactures atrazine, says on its website that it stands firmly behind the safety of atrazine and that there are no known human effects from the recommended use of this herbicide. Under the heightened scrutiny, timber companies quietly decided not to spray atrazine and 2,4-D near populated areas this spring. But that meant the state said it couldn't test for those chemicals either. At a meeting held with area residents where those announcements were made, the state health department promised the study would resume in 2013.
This investigation is ongoing. We are going to stay here. We are committed to this investigation.
The industry says it welcomes the state's investigation into its practices.
And if there is data that shows that the practices need to be altered, the industry is more than willing to look at what recommendations could be employed.
The only change many concerned residents will accept is for the governor to call a halt to spraying on company-owned forest land, or at least, they say, keep it away from where people live.
You can find a link to the original story from the Center for Investigative Reporting on the Rundown.